memories come back.
Yeah, it's amazing. I used to live in the back.
I think the world gives me enough excuses. You're black, so you have an excuse. They don't look at you the same, so you have an excuse. You're a teenage mother, so you have an excuse. You're a woman, so you have an excuse. So many excuses in the world. Why not be the difference maker? Why not give yourself a limit? Why not look at the ceiling and say, that's just my floor? Why not?
I've always been a nurturer. Even in my brokenness, I was a nurturer. I always took care of someone, somewhere, at some time, for some reason. People have always gravitated to me for whatever reason and will pour out their whole hearts. So making it legal, making the education what it should be, and making me be able to do this and get paid for it, why not?
My name is Akia Blandon. And I am a nurse practitioner, a registered nurse practitioner.
Did I think that I would do it? No, I didn't. I didn't. But here I am.
I am a Long Beach transplant, and I spent many years here. So I grew up in Manhattan. But Long Beach, I was 17 years old when I moved to Long Beach. My mom and I were not very close initially. We're thick as thieves now, but we weren't growing up. I don't think we liked each other much. I think I was a tough kid. It was hard to parent me. I think I needed some different things. And I think that sometimes when you have a unique child in your home, not having God to guide you on how to parent that child can make it difficult. So I totally was a difficult child. Internally, having gone through some things as a child, I was unsettled. I was emotionally unsettled. And if I met with my challenges, and the challenges didn't have to be in school, if I met with any challenge, my MO was to run. And so I ran. I worked in Oceanside, and Long Beach had rooms available for rent. And so I made my way to Long Beach to rent a room and worked in Oceanside. I knew no one. I had no one. I just worked in Oceanside, and my son's father was from Long Beach. So that was his family. It wasn't mine. I had a condition when I was pregnant with my son called hyperemesis gravidarum, which is essentially you couldn't sustain any food. You couldn't keep any food down. So I was throwing up a lot. So I worked at the food town in Oceanside, but unfortunately being sick, having hyperemesis gravidarum, which happens to some pregnant women, I was unable to keep working. So I've always been stubborn my entire life. I don't think that'll ever change. And I refused to go back home. And so it was just like, I had a choice. I could stay here, go on public assistance and try to figure out my life until I had my son, or I could go back home to my mom's house with my other four sisters, which didn't really make sense to me. Comfortable standing online in wall bounds to get your food stamps? I said I was stubborn. I might add prideful to that. No, it was not gonna work for me. I didn't like the vibe. I didn't like standing online with people waiting for food stamps. It felt beneath me. Like, it felt like, this is not what I'm designed for. I'm bigger than this. And not to say that it's a problem to have a stepping stone of social services, but that's what social services should be, a stepping stone, not a stumbling block. I think the idea of having a child at 17 and having no high school diploma, how was I going to provide for him? That definitely was pressure.
I'm swayed by the emotions of anything, God, but it is your time, God, that your people would cry out unto you.
I always say my TJ, my oldest son, saved my life. When you have children, it's no longer about you. It's about them.
All right, none of this would be possible if it wasn't for this guy. I know, none of this would be possible if it wasn't for me. I put the battery in your back.
And having him made me say, okay, what's your issue, chick? Get it together, get some counseling. Figure out what's making you tick, what's making you run, and get it together, because you have this little person depending on you. Someone spoke to me about a place called the Adult Learning Center here in Long Beach. And it was a center that was equipped to assist adults transition to a productive level of adulthood and limit the usage of social services for that adult. I went to the Adult Learning Center because going back to high school, I mean, I was in my senior year, but going back to high school wasn't an option. I went to high school in New York City. And again, I wasn't going back home. So I went to the Adult Learning Center and they did something, they did a testing. You took a test when you walked in to determine what your aptitude was or where they had to put you in classes in order to get you ready for the GED prior to you going through or going to any of the other programs that they had available. So I walked into the Adult Learning Center and took the test that they had. They needed you to score a 12.9. They needed to get everybody to 12.9 or better in order to take the GED. That was their marker to determine that you could take the GED. I scored a 13.9 when I walked in. They looked at me and said, why are you here? Why aren't you in school? And I gave the counselor a little bit of my story. They scheduled my GED test. I took it. I passed the first time. I didn't study, because I've never been one who struggles with school. I've always excelled in school. The mere fact that I left is quite interesting. So I took my GED, I got it. The counselor said, okay, chef or nurse, what do you want to do?
As women, and I got to speak specifically to being women, you know, and having the ability to bring forth life, okay, makes us warriors in my eyes. And as warriors, you know, we pick and choose our battles, okay? And some battles we're gonna go in and just kill it and slaughter. And some battles we're gonna be like, this one you got, but I'll be back. So the strength that she has is the strength of a warrior. Because she doesn't give up, she'll be back, but she never gives up.
I'm pretty bold, naturally. And so academia never scared me. And remember, I wanted to be a forensic pathologist, which is a physician. So I didn't look at it like that. I didn't look at it like I needed any extra strength or energy to become a nurse. I just looked at it like, this is something that I do, I can do, and I will do it. I don't really think anybody knew what I was going through, because again, I'm stubborn. So strong-willed is my nature. I think the dynamic that changed, that kind of made people understand a little bit more, is I got pregnant again. Thank you. with my second son.
From who?
Oh gosh, so my second son's dad was a deacon in the church. So this lovely church literally split in half. Some were team him, others were team me. That was the, and being a believer, being a Christian, couldn't have sex outside of marriage. And Pentecostal church, forget it. We had to go and sit down. So you had to be in every service. You couldn't go out. Oh, it was terrible. And I did all of this without parents or without, like, he had his whole family here and I had no family here, which is why in that time, like, the Myras and the Reginas and the Christines of the world were so integral because they became my family. They were my sisters. You know, they supported me. They held me up. And even though they didn't hold up my sin, right, the sex outside of marriage, they didn't shame me for having done it. And so I went through that here in this church. And then in school, my classmates rallied because part of becoming a licensed practical nurse has a lot of lifting and pushing and pulling. And they would do it for me. They would like rally and do it for me so that I didn't miss school or anything like that. Lots of tears, lots of God wise, lots of questioning. But the interesting thing is God was so faithful during that time. I could remember preachers coming from out of town for revivals and they would call me out and speak into my life.
She just keeps going, like, amidst like all of the craziness that happens, like at her job now, or when she's tired, when she's exhausted, when she doesn't want to go back, she still does and she kicks butt every day. Regardless of where I may end up, she's always going to be my rock, my foundation, everything, even if I don't even realize it in the time. You know, when I think she's wrong and she's always right, she's always going to be like my stronghold. Like, I know I will always have her there, and that means everybody doesn't have that. So I just thank God that he gave me her. Even though she says that I'm a blessing, like, it's really no comparison. She's pretty cool.
You have 5 children, a single parent, and you're doing this by yourself with going to work, making sure your children are okay, and then doing nursing school of all things at the same time. But she had this drive and she's like, yeah, I gotta do this and I have to do this for my kids. I was married at the time, so I had somebody, you know, with my son. She was just her, and a lot of times she depended on her family. Her sisters were a big part of that also. And so there was a lot of times where she didn't know what was gonna happen, how was she gonna get through to the next paycheck. And there was just so many things, and the kids were going through it, and they're young, and they're going through it. And it was just, you know, days where we would leave here, and actually she'd have to go do laundry, take the 5 kids with her. So I'm with her lugging bags of laundry down to her car, you know, and putting a laundry bag, whether it was in the cart or car or whatever, to take, go, she was getting ready to go do laundry and then feed the kids and then still have to study for school.
We've had some crazy times. You know, I'm 27 years old and I haven't always been a saint. But even in me not being a saint in my 27 years, she's never left me. And I've been through it all. I've been through the worst of the worst. I've gotten into trouble, kicked out of school. And most parents would disown their child or have some sort of malice or ill will towards their child. And all the money, all the college pays, all the money I've made you spend on college, you know, I didn't even complete that. And her getting her doctorates, it's given me the motivation to go back to school. So, you know, even in my downfalls, she's always loved me. Like, she saw me as her precious little boy out the delivery room.
I remember she used to work nights when I was really young, probably like 3 or 4, when we first moved to New York City. She was a night nurse. So my aunt Ebony used to come and watch us, and I believe we used to have a nanny at one point, but she obviously was the hardest working person that, you know, I've ever known. So she always wanted a better life for us from being in the city. So she made sure that was the case. So she always made time for us, but she always made sure that she was working so that we could have enough, and we could not only have enough, but, you know, go on vacation to Florida and do things like that. Sometimes she'll do this thing where she like bothers you. She'll text you or she'll call you and she'll say, "Hey, Joelle, like, can you get the remote for me?" And I'm like, "Mom, where's the remote?" She's like, "Yeah, it's on my dresser." And I'm like, "Mom, I'm in the basement. Like, are you not gonna, aren't you gonna get up and get the remote?" And she's like, "Come on, Joelle, you're not gonna get the remote for me." So, you know, I'd go up to her room and, you know, from that she would create a conversation. And, you know, that's the time where we'd find, before she'd go to bed, even if she had to wake up at 5 a.m. or if it's 12 at night, she'll find that time to just talk to us and say, like, "How are you? I love you." And, you know.
It's her passion, her drive to want more. And I think the example that she sets for her kids have allowed her to continue to drive, and then making sure that she accomplishes things that she wants to accomplish. There's something unique about her that even in the midst of the low moments, she's able to tap into that strength that God has given her.
My sorority, Chi Eta Phi Sorority Incorporated, motto is service for humanity. It's a natural fit. Nurturer, serving. It's a natural fit. People say to this day, I have some extra hours in my clock or some extra time on my watch that I just get stuff done.
Get 24 hours in a day. He gives it extra days, extra weeks, extra hours.
I remember running. I actually do. So I went to school in the morning, all day school. The kids had a show that I had to leave school, go to the show, went to the show, stayed there. I had the show was like from 3 to 5. I had a 6 o'clock class in the evening because I was doing the accelerated program. So I refused to do it in anything less than a year because my mom told me you have a year for me to help you. And she meant that. And so I had to go back to school. The following morning was a final, but I had to work 11 to 7 the night. So I went home, dozed for about 1.5, 2 hours, got up, went to, funny story, moved my car from the right side of the street to the wrong side of the street because I was so exhausted, went to work, worked, came home, showered, took the kids to school, came back, and I got a 98 on that test. It was like the Lord was just downloading stuff. Pick B. I don't know. But yeah, my life looked a lot like that in nursing school.
I think she has an innate ability to find strength within herself. Because she, even at this point in her life, she juggles so much. And that's a testament to where she is from. Her background, the foundational elements of her life. The God in her, number one, and just the ability to be an example to her children. For me, the drive for her right now is seeing her coming from a person with a GED to almost becoming a doctor in a few weeks. So I think just to be the better version of herself at all times, that to me is one of the motivating factors in her life.
LPN, associate degree, RN, bachelor's degree, master's degree, postmaster's certificate, and to become an NP, soon to be doctorate of nursing practice. Other people occupy all of those roles, and what impact do they make on the world? How did they reach back? How did they pull somebody else up? How did they encourage somebody else to move beyond what they see or what they think? Titles, they're good. Some of the money that comes with titles pay the bills. But I think when people see this little brown girl, who's not yet 45, going through, having gone through everything that I've gone through, do it and do it here and not looking like what she's been through, it's motivational. It's inspirational. It'll help. It'll encourage. It'll lift. It screams far louder than any of my titles ever will. I think if me with five children could do it, anybody can. It's important that people see themselves. And so somebody might look at me and say, oh, the little brown girl from New York City did it, so I can do it. Somebody else might have two children and feel like they want to give up and think of me with five children and say, you know what, I can do it, I can make it. Somebody may have been abused as a child and think that that's enough to give up and will look at me and hear my story and know, no, she didn't give up, she can make it. Somebody could think that God doesn't hear them, see them, know them, and will hear my story and know that he does. Even in the silence, he does. So the reason I wanted to make my documentary of sorts is to leave a legacy for people to see that she did it, so I can too.